Yeah, we have handouts that we're gonna start handing out here. Okay?
Yeah, I've got some more.
You have some more? I've got 100 here, honey.
Great, okay.
You have more outside? Okay, so nobody can complain about lack of handouts.
Great.
David, thank you.
Thank you very much. I don't know how I come up here after all of the things she started out with. It was great. But I do want you to have a handout. And as she's making sure you get them, let me just preface. I think I heard as I came in at the very beginning, Christina asked, why are you here? And I think that is the most important question. Why? How many people know the name Simon Sinek? I was going through the airport one day, and every time I go through the airport, I stop at the stores and I look at the business books, and Simon Sinek had a business book there, and I looked at it and I was fascinated with it, so I bought it, shown it to my wife, and my wife said, gee, you like that because he thinks the way you do. Well, the difference is Simon Sinek is a scientist, I'm not. But Simon Sinek did a TED Talk. Does anyone know what a TED Talk is?
Yes.
I really recommend that you look him up and look at his TED Talk. It's like a 7-minute talk. And Simon says that most people can tell you what they do. Some people can tell you how they do what they do. But very few people can tell you why they do what they do. And so I want tonight to have you look at why do you do what you do in real estate and see if there may be some other things that can give you some of the benefits that you want and not have some of the costs, liabilities, or other things in the process. Now, I think my talk was billed as a talk on master leasing. So let me define that before we do anything else. Master leasing is where I lease a house from Gail over here, or lease some property from Gail, and I turn around and sublease it to Chuck and take something out of the middle, some cash flow, some upswing, something else. Does that make sense? And I'm going to use master leasing and sandwich leasing synonymously. And, you know, it's been done for years and years and years in the commercial industry. So let's just start with this hotel, just to give you an idea. Probably one group owns the ground under the hotel. They lease that ground long-term to someone who built the hotel. Then the folks who built the hotel and owned the hotel, they lease to Hilton? I'm not sure. No, there's Marriott, I think. They lease a 10-year lease to Marriott to manage it. Then Marriott subleases the catering to some other organization. There's a whole series of leases probably right on this building right now, okay? So you can have a whole bunch of them, and the only thing I did is I looked at that model and I moved it over to the residential arena. So does everyone have a sheet now? Great, so let's start on the first page, and let me just tell you, you're not here for me, I'm here for you. So if you don't like the way where I'm headed with this, change it. You know, I like interaction. You can, I'll talk on anything as long as it has to do with property management, master leasing, or anything in between. But let's start here and see if it makes sense, and then we'll see how that works. Peter Fortunato has, well, first of all, how many people know Peter Fortunato? Okay, take a look around and see the guys. Keep your hands up. People who know Peter Fortunato, you ought to talk to those folks sometime tonight and find out more about him. But he's someone you all ought to know. You really ought to know. Peter has some wonderful classes. He has a picture of a house that he segmented into different group parts to show the benefits that a house or real estate can give you. And I just wrote down the various benefits that Peter pointed out because I think he pretty much covers them all. First thing is real estate can provide income, right? Pretty obvious. It can provide tax benefits, okay? It can provide a profit. You can flip it. Growth, you know, the market goes up. It can provide growth. Management. You know, some of us like management. I'm a landlord. I very much like being a landlord. I think it's the easy man's way to be in the real estate business. I'm going to try and convince you in a short time this evening that there aren't many moving parts to management if you have your systems in place. It just is a great way to do business. And the income comes in whether you want to work or not once you get it all in place. Whereas flipping and all the other things you've got to do, rehab, if you're sick or something goes wrong in your life, if you're not working, the income stops. Use. Real estate, you can use it. You can live in it. You can run a business out of it. Amortization is a key benefit that most people miss. And amortization is that if you just can tie up a piece of property with amortizing debt on it that someone else can pay off, that even if the market goes to heck and goes down, at some point in time, it'll be free and clear and you'll make a bunch of money and you'll make more cash flow. Amortization is a wonderful, wonderful benefit, and don't ever miss it. It's really great. Security is that you can secure your promise to do something to a piece of real estate. In this state, you typically use trust deeds and you glue your promise, which is typically a promise to repay debt to the real estate, so it can offer security. Well, let's look at how many of those same benefits master leasing can provide, because I think you'll be very surprised. People don't have any idea, by and large, the value of leases. So let's look at this. And I'm going to give you some examples. I'm going to give you some people's real names and real locations, and you can look them up and call them, and they're real people, and they've done some neat things. Income. Well, John Alexander is out of Sarasota, Florida. And John's a sharp guy, and he leased a house in Sarasota from an estate. And the beneficiaries of the estate, none of them lived in Sarasota. So his lease stated that he didn't owe any rent at all. He just had to make sure he caretake the house and kept it up and perhaps improved it over time. He subleased it. Every dime that he gets in, other than what he puts into the house, is his to keep. That's fairly profitable. Dwayne Talley out of Bonita Springs. Dwayne controlled a condo complex, the sales in a condo complex, and a lot of the condos down there did not allow for short-term rentals. But his complex did allow for short-term vacation rentals. They were bought by and large for people who are planning for retirement. They'd use it a couple of weeks a year and want to rent it out the rest of the time. And people would approach Dwayne and want to put their properties in the quote-unquote rental pool. And the way Dwayne allowed them to do that was they had to lease their properties to his company. But he told me that from Christmas to Easter, he made $140,000 in 1 year on those leases and subleases. Those are vacation rentals. That's a key time in Southwest Florida to generate income. The rest of the year might not be much, but that's pretty good income for 3 or 4 months. Jan Leisure in California, out in Pebble Beach. I've known Jan for a long time. She actually came to a class that I did in Orlando, Florida, went back to Pebble Beach. The market was such that properties weren't selling. And so she went to owners who had 9 properties listed for sale, and she made a deal with them that said, I'd like to lease your properties on a month-to-month basis. And if they go under contract, all I need is 60 days notice and I'll cancel the lease and square everything away. She leased those properties for 6 months, put some furniture in them, subleased them as vacation rentals, and made $81,000. Right? That's an opportunity. And think about it. She didn't have much money in the deal. None of these guys needed a whole bunch of cash to do what they did. Matt Funk, out of Tampa, Florida. Matt had a printing company. For 2 years, he printed my manual for my class in Tampa. And the second year, he came to the class. He immediately sold his printing company, started master leasing. He works from around his swimming pool, raising 2 kids. He's replaced his income. He's working on replacing his wife's income. He's the one that's raising the kids and he's just doing master leasing out of his house. Very little overhead. My son-in-law, I have a son-in-law who was a sports writer for a newspaper, and he moved around various different places. He was in Colorado Springs, which is where I raised my family, and ultimately ended up in Pocatello, Idaho. My daughter was working part-time for the university, making more than he was making as a newspaper sports writer at that time. Newspapers just haven't been getting the pull that they used to once upon a time. We brought them back to see us before we went back to Florida in the fall. So they were in Colorado Springs, and I drove them to the airport at 6 o'clock one morning. And they owned a house in Colorado Springs because they previously lived there, and when they moved, they kept it and rented it out, and it was a good little house. And Kurt said to me, he said, you know, I think I want to buy another rental in Colorado Springs. And I said, it's a good town. I think that'd be great. And then he said, you know, I think we'd like to move back here. And I said, well, it was a great town for us to raise a family. What would you do here? And my daughter chimed in and said, Dad, you don't understand. We've been up all night talking, and we'd like a hostile takeover of your company. And I said, well, I'm not big on partnerships. The only partnership I want is with my spouse. We've been married 43 years. She's in the back, Mary. And I think that many partnerships are easy to get into, but hard to get out of. And so we created another business for him, a parallel business, and he has master leased somewhere between 90 and 100 houses, and he supports my daughter and their three kids, and he's currently in his motorhome in Yellowstone National Park. Has a nice lifestyle. He teaches, since he's really into sports, he teaches all of his kids virtually every sport known to man, and he's much more balanced than I am. He and my daughter will not allow me to say one word about real estate on a Sunday ever. I'm banned from their house if I ever bring up the word real estate. But those are income examples, and there are different kinds of examples, and just to kind of give you an idea, tax benefits. Let's talk about tax benefits. You know, there are two basic kinds of different master leases. One would be a fixed lease, where I would agree to rent Chuck's property for X number of dollars a month. I'd be willing to give him 12 post-dated checks so he could go around the world and once a month put a check in the bank. And I'd guarantee to pay the rent whether it's vacant or full, and I might take care of all the expenses up to some kind of a stop loss. That would be defined as a fixed lease. You can also have a performance lease. And a performance lease would say, I'll pay you a percentage of what I get if and when I get it. If I don't get anything, I won't owe you anything, okay? Now that, for a lot of people will say, that sounds like property management. Well, it sounds like it, but it's not. And I'm going to make sure that I differentiate that to you so you can see the difference. And I'll start by saying, if how many people in the room are property managers? Let me ask that right up front. Great. I was one for years. I became a fee manager in 1981, and I was a fee manager until October 1st of 96, at which time I canceled all of my agency relationships and turned around and leased the properties I used to manage. But for you managers, think about this for a second. What kind of income is property management income? Earned income, right? Earned income. What kind of income is rental income? Passive income, right? So for managers, if you change the title on the top of your form from management agreement to lease, what happens to your income? On $100,000 of comparative income, either management income or $100,000 of master leasing income, the taxes on the management income is approximately $31,200. On the master leased income, it's $19,100. What's the difference?
Self-employment.
No self-employment tax. So if you do nothing else at all but change from managing as an agent under the rules of agency to leasing on a performance basis, you've just given yourself a significant increase in income. Okay? So that's a nice tax benefit, but let's look at that just a little bit further. If you manage property, and let me give you the example so you can see the numbers involved for a second. And these are totally arbitrary numbers. They have nothing to do with my business or figures that we were involved in, but they're easy numbers to look at. If someone manages property for a 10% management fee, that would equate to a performance master lease where I agreed to pay 90% of what I collected if and when I collected it. Do you follow that? It's the same thing. So, except for there's some benefits to the owner. One is the owner now is actively involved in managing his property because he has not hired a manager. He's leased directly to me, which may give him an economic benefit. May be able to deduct more than $25,000 or $25,000 against other income. There's a number of things that might help him. But more than that, in dealing with the IRS, I think it's better to show less income and less expenses than more income and more expenses if the bottom line is exactly the same. Do you follow that? So why, from a agency standpoint, what are some of the differences? If I'm working as your agent under an employment agreement that I am supposed to take off my glasses, put on your glasses, and I have a fiduciary responsibility to do everything to your best interest. The problem is that as a property manager, my goal is to maximize my business's bottom line. And that's why most states find that they need to regulate property management and license it to protect the public because there's that potential conflict of interest. Do you follow me? Whereas if I master lease your property, the only reason Chuck would ever lease me his property is if it's in Chuck's best interest to do that. And for me, I'm only going to lease his property if it's in my best interest. I'm not working for Chuck. He's not working for me. Another key benefit for an owner is that if I am working for Chuck as his agent under an employment agreement, he is vicariously liable for any of my acts that take place while I am under that employment agreement. What's the biggest one that comes to mind? A fair housing complaint. If I get hit with a fair housing complaint, it flows right through to the owner. Okay, big, big deal. The biggest case I'm familiar with is years ago there was a case in Washington, D.C. area that an on-site resident manager failed to rent to a family with children, which is a protected class under familial status. And the owner was found guilty to the tune of $2.41 million. That's an Excedrin headache. Now, if instead of doing it that way, he'd leased it to someone instead of hired a manager, now his relationship has nothing to do with the occupants in the property. There's no vicarious liability there. Do you see the difference? Okay, so let's look some more here. There's one other thing in terms of tax benefits, and that is there anything you can't write off on a piece of real estate that you own? What? Land. Exactly right, you can't write it off. Whereas if you're master leasing the property, every dime that you pay is an expense. It's a very efficient way to deal with stuff. And for what it's worth, and it's probably here someplace else, but I'll tell you now, the IRS says that if you lease a property for 30 years or more, you own it. And you can depreciate it. Isn't that interesting? And I think I have an example, so I'll hold off until I get to that. Profit. You can lease and sell your lease, or you can sell an interest in your lease. Now, I had some wonderful mentors that taught me great things in real estate, and one of the very best, and a good friend of mine, was a guy by the name of Jack Miller. And Jack told me a story once that involved Joe West. And Joe West was a fireman from Pascagoula, Mississippi, and he owned a whole bunch of real estate. And Jack got in a deal with Joe that they were somehow involved with leasing this property. Jack really came up with the money, Joe came up with the property, and Joe was managing it because he was there on site. And Joe called him up one day and said, "Jack, you know, I'm a lousy manager. Do you mind if out of my share of the funds, I hire a manager to do a better job for us?" So Joe, rather than pay a manager, gave away half of his half to a manager to manage it. So Joe was in the deal with no money and had nothing to do and had a 25% interest in the property. Not bad. Not bad. There's so many ways to do business with these things. I had an office manager who worked with me for 9.5 years and retired. And when she retired, I decided I no longer wanted any employees. And my wife and I get along very well. And so I thought, gee whiz, Mary will come into the office and we enjoy each other, so we'll just be around each other 24/7. And we'll get some things done. And she let me know in no uncertain terms very, very quickly that if the marriage was going to survive, she was not coming into the office. And the problem with that meant that I had to do all the bookkeeping. And I'm systems oriented, so I had a bunch of systems. But if you're dealing with receivables and payables on over 100 houses, it takes time. I don't care how good you are, it still takes time. And I wasn't crazy about that. Because she wouldn't do it. I mean, that's the bottom line, she wouldn't do it. She still won't do it. So on the properties that I was master leasing, I had another firm that wanted to do business with me. And I said, my standard answer, I don't like partnerships. And they said, well, we have an underutilized bookkeeper, and we'd love to keep him a little busier, and we'd love to generate some more income. So for a period of about 6 months, I worked out this kind of a Rube Goldberg way that I might do business with them. And what we ultimately came up with is I leased them my master lease business. And so we had three leases on every property. The owner would lease to my company would lease to their company would lease to the occupants. And what they wanted out of the deal was, yes, they wanted a little more income, they wanted to keep their bookkeeper busy, but they really wanted me looking over their shoulder, fine-tuning their business without nickel and diming them to death. I wanted to get out of doing the bookkeeping, and so it was a great deal. And I had thought that if I'd sold my business, and I don't have any idea if these numbers are right, but in my mind, this is what I thought would be the case. I thought if I sold my business, I'd probably get 1 year's income paid over 3 years. That's what I thought I'd get for my management business or master leasing business. And what I did instead was I got them involved and I got 40% of what I got before with no overhead forever. And I thought 40% forever was better than 33 1/3% for 3 years. And that worked pretty well. That worked pretty well. So you can do things to profit. I mean, I think that was a nice profit for me as to how I could sublease to multiple people. I dealt with the owners. I was the conductor of the band. They had to adhere to my contracts. They had to do things my way. I could pull them back at any point in time that they didn't, but that's how I accomplished my objective. Growth. Growth, which, you know, a lot of people think that I teach a course on lease options. I generally don't. I like leases better than doing lease options. Why? I think that if you go for a lease option, people think you have more than a lease, and so they either want to charge you additional rent, or they want to charge you something for the option consideration. Whereas I think that if you have a long-term lease that's well secured to the property, you have a stealth option. and it costs you less. I leased a house one time for 35 years at a fixed rent. And I secured my lease with a deed of trust that said if the owner failed to pay the underlying encumbrances or the taxes or insurance, I could foreclose him. 10 years later, I was given half the appreciation on the property to remove my lease from the property. That was a profitable way of doing business. You know, if you have questions or comments or you want me to go someplace else, do jump in, because I don't have a script per se, but I'm just trying to give you some examples of how you can do an awful lot of good with good leases.
Can you run through that last example again?
I leased a single family. I had a friend, and this was not a walking wounded individual. He was a real estate broker. I knew him well. We were friendly. We had lunch one day. And in sitting down for lunch, he said, I've got this house, and I want you to have the joy of management. I said, you got the wrong house. You got to get me a better house. He said, you don't understand. I took this back in foreclosure, and I don't want to manage the property. I said, I don't either. He said, well, tell me what you would do. I said, I'll give you a lease option for 10 years, or I'll give you a sandwich lease for 35. Now let's look at which maybe makes sense to both parties. This was an individual that was in the note business, meaning he got his money from interest and also return of principal. And the problem was he was eating his principal as it came in. And if he remained in title on the property, he might get some tax benefits from it. And so we looked at both ways of doing business from his perspective. Now, he was 57 years old. And so you'd say, why would he lease me the property for 35 years at age 57? Any ideas? Someone said it, I think. Who said, say that again. Kids. He had two sons that he was convinced that the day he dropped dead, they would both buy something red that drove very fast. And he loved being able to control them from the grave. And so go try and make a deal with Clyde. He might make a deal with you long term. You just don't know what people will do until you talk to them. Don't decide for them what they will or won't do. It's amazing if you talk to them. Now, I mentioned that a lease over 30 years, the IRS says you own it, correct? And you can depreciate it. How much could I depreciate?
90%.
Of what?
Of the total price.
What's my basis? Basis is zero. Every dime I'm paying, I'm writing off right up front. There's nothing to depreciate. If I paid something up front for the lease, different situation. Now, if the IRS says I own it, do you think he claimed a sale on his tax return? Not really sure. I'm not his tax guy. He fills out his tax return, I fill out my tax return. I'm not really sure. Very interesting situation. There's some funny things that can happen.
Question.
Yeah.
Is the broker that he's aware that after 30 years that he's going to own the property, then why he leased for 35 years to you?
Why did he lease the property to me for 35 years? You know, it's amazing that if you have trust with people and they have a problem, to solve the problem, they will pay well oftentimes. This was a house that was not a house that I would want to own or most people might want to own. He trusted me. He knew, because we'd done other deals, that if we needed to unwind the deal, we could unwind the deal. My objective was to find a tenant that I could force to buy the house. That was my objective. And once I found that tenant that I could force to buy the house, I wanted to do a 1031 tax-deferred exchange into a better property. And I agreed that I would pay the difference in price in going up to the better property if I could keep my rent the same. Or he could pay the difference and I'd raise my rent. Okay? We found a tenant that we forced to buy. And what we found was we found an individual who had two twin boys. It was a two-bedroom house. It could have been a three-bedroom, but they'd made it a larger bedroom without a partition. He really wanted a bigger house, had a one-car garage. This guy was a pipe fitter. He also was a cook. And he went back to Mexico a couple times a month, and he would somehow bring some very exotic cowboy boots back with him from Mexico, which he sold at the flea market. And the problem was, with all of his SKUs for these boots, he could only bring a certain amount to the flea market, and he would show the samples at the flea market and say, come to my shop. And the shop was his garage, and in between all the 2x4 studs, he had little partitions where he had all the boots displayed. And if he moved, he'd lose his customer base. And we told him we were selling the house. So we forced him to buy the house when he really didn't want to buy the house. At that point, Bob Link, my friend, said, you get all the appreciation from when you put the lease on the property. And my response was, there's plenty of appreciation, let's split it 50-50. And he said, okay, I think the value was this when we started. I said, let's raise it up to the next $5,000. If you treat people the way they'd like to be treated, you'll do many, many, many more deals with them. I bought another house from the same guy at 9% interest. He carried all the financing in second position behind another, on another property that I owned. Once we made the deal, I said, okay, if we take the payments of 9%, and we reduce, I'm sorry, I bought it at 0% interest. And I said, okay, if you get audited by the IRS, they may charge you 9%. So let's see what the payments would be, the same payments at 9%, what would the purchase price be? It dropped the value of the house over, I think it dropped it like $12,000. You can make unusual deals with people if you do what you say you're going to do. And older folks, oftentimes, maybe not Clyde, but a lot of older folks, they're much more concerned about having a return of their principal than an amount on their principal. Many people will promise big returns on principal, but the principal never goes back. Do you agree with that, Clyde? Did I answer your question all right?
Yeah,
okay. So I've done a lot of business with this guy. I borrowed well more than $100,000 on other things, and we've done business over time. This was a good transaction for both of us. Growth. Growth coupled with an option or a long-term secured lease. I gave you the first one, but let me give you two others. I had a family through my church, and they were young veterans, and at that time, I think interest rates were 18 or 19%. I remember when they were 22% for a very short period of time. And the Colorado Housing Authority gave low interest loans to veterans, so it was a CHAFA VA loan, but the veteran had to live in the property. And they were transferred out of town. So they couldn't rent it, they couldn't sell it, it was a terrible market. And so we went to the Colorado Housing Authority and got permission to lease the property since they couldn't sell it at that time. And I put a lease option on the property, and then I sub-leased with a first right of refusal option to my tenant. And I made cash flow during the holding period, and the tenant ultimately bought it, and I got a profit on the other end when they bought the property. Do you see what I did there?
I don't see where you got the profit.
I can tell you exactly where I got it. I had an option to buy the property at $65,000 and I sold it for $69,000. Actually, I made $5,000, so the numbers are slightly off. But my sub-lease option was for a different figure, obviously, than I had in it, and so I had a profit figure there.
So it was two, you had a lease option.
Yes, I subleased with a first right of refusal option. Very, very different. What's the difference? My option was a right without an offsetting liability. I could exercise my right at any time. My subtenant had a limited option. He had an option if I could perform. Because if I gave him a pure option and something ever happened and I could not deliver title for whatever reason, the owner, then I'd be liable because I promised something that I couldn't perform on. So you gotta be very careful with your documentation as to how you do these things, okay? My son-in-law leased a property which he just closed in a couple of weeks ago. He leased it for a period of time, but he had an option on it, and he made, I think it was over $70,000 when he sold the property just this month. So there's lots of potential for growth if you put some of these together. Yes?
Do you know the numbers on that one?
My wife may, and I can find out for you. I've been told them, but no, I can't remember them offhand. Sorry. He consults with me less and less and less as he's doing more and more of this. Yes.
Why would somebody do a performance lease?
Why would they do a performance lease? Well, isn't that look like dealing with a management company? Isn't it much the same? You know, what you're going to negotiate on doing these leases is essentially you don't want to ask anyone a question where the answer is yes or no. You want to ask them the question of, do you want to take the risk and you get the reward, or do you want me to take the risk and I'll get the reward? If they take the risk and they get the reward, it's going to be a performance lease and they pay for all the expenses a la carte. If I take the risk and I get the reward, okay, I'm going to figure out what's the market rent, then I'm going to deduct for, I'll actually have them do it. I'll say, how much should we take off for management? Because I'm not nonprofit. I don't work for free. And you'd be absolutely amazed how many people say 10%. So then I'll say, okay, so how much do I take off for maintenance if I'm going to do the maintenance? Well, some number. Well, how much for vacancy? Well, some more number. And then how much, if I'm willing to take those risks, then there's one more category I ought to get, and that's profit. And so, depending on how long your lease is, you've got those two options. But the one thing that anyone has an advantage over a management company is, you don't have a one-size-fits-all. You can determine what the owner's needs are, give them what they need, and take everything else. So think about this for a second. Have any of you ever hired a property management company? Okay, so you call up the management company. What's the first thing you ask? What do you charge, right? What do you charge? Well, someone calls me up and they say, what do you charge? And I say, well, that depends. I got to know a little bit more about what your situation is, and you got to know a little bit more about what we think we do. Sometimes we don't charge anything. When can we get together and talk? That's a much better approach.
Oh, yeah.
It's a much better approach. Sure.
Sorry if you covered this. I came in a little bit late, so you may have already covered this. But my question is, my request is, could you give us some examples in this market where properties have appreciated so much and where it's really a seller's market, some examples of people who want to do these leases?
Anyone who would consider using a management company is a target person for you. Now, how can you find those folks? I think Jimmy Napier has the best approach of anyone I've ever heard. How many people know the name Jimmy Napier? And Clyde's got some information on Jimmy Napier that you ought to corner him after the class. I think he's doing something down the road. Jimmy Napier would call for sale by owner properties. And he'd call them up, and Jimmy would say, I'm calling about the house for rent. And the owner would say, it's not for rent, it's for sale. And Jimmy would say, oh, I thought it was for rent. No, it's for sale. And then Jimmy, only as Jimmy can do, I can't do it, but Jimmy would say, oh. And he wouldn't say another word. It maybe hold the phone out here, but he wouldn't say another word. And maybe 30 seconds goes by, and every once in a while someone say, well, I've been trying to sell it, and it didn't sell, maybe I rent it. Boom, you got one. I mean, what an efficient way to do business. The other way to do it is knock on doors. knock on doors. And if you're not licensed, you can look at a neighborhood you like, and you can go right to the ones for sale if you're not licensed, knock on the door and say, I can't buy it, but I'd like to rent it. I mean, people have problems. People have upside down houses still, believe it or not. They can't sell them. They're transferred out of town. There's so many opportunities. We have a friend in Colorado, Loveland, Colorado, I think, that he aligned himself with a title company that sent him names and addresses of owners of properties in a certain area that he liked that had their tax notices sent to a different address. And he'd go around and take a picture of their property, turn it into a postcard. And on the postcard, he'd say, I guess you didn't know what was happening. If I can help, please call. Now, a postcard's really terrific, because any way you get it in your mailbox, either side, you gotta read it. You gotta read it. And you see a picture of your house, and maybe the house looked great, but he said, I guess you didn't know what was happening. If I can help, give me a call. He built up a lot of business relatively quickly. He did something else that I thought was very, very, very creative. He actually bought an old four-part color photo of a balloon over his town, looking down at all these balloons and the whole town. And he put together this big brochure that made him look like he was the biggest outfit around. And he sent that, and he had pictures of beautiful houses inside. And he sent that to out-of-town owners. And one day an owner called him up and said, why is a picture of my house in your brochure? He'd taken nice-looking houses from around the community, and he made a decision that if he ever did it again, he'd go to a different town to get pictures of houses. But there's lots of ways. Anyone who has need of a management company has your need, and you've got much more flexibility in making a deal with them. Does that make sense? Yeah. Dave. Yeah, I've got that down here, coming up. I've got that down. So management, you manage the property, and some of us like management. I really do like management. I like the interaction with my tenants. I think my tenants are my assets. I mean, they really are. Houses are not assets. Vacant houses eat you. They don't feed you, but tenants feed you. And so you got to understand that, and you got to treat tenants. You know, what's the golden rule? Treat others as you'd like to be treated. The platinum rule works much better. Treat others as they'd like to be treated, because maybe they don't want to be treated quite the way you would, and your job as a landlord is to find out how each of your tenants wants to be treated. Treat them that way, and you'll get them to do wonderful things for you. Okay, so you can manage it yourself. You can hire a manager, or you can sublease it to another investor operator, as I did. Use. Obviously, you can use the property yourself, or you can have permission to allow someone else to use it through a sublease. Amortization, that's tougher. I have not gotten amortization from doing a master lease. But you could, theoretically, you could have a lease option and option the equity on the property, so as the loan paid down, then you were getting the buildup or some percentage of that. Do you follow me? Do you see what I'm saying there? That could happen. If a loan is amortized as it pays down, if I'm optioning the equity is growing. I'm not optioning a price, I'm optioning the equity. Comment?
No, I'm just saying, describe it in more detail.
Okay. Okay, great. Yeah. Yeah, of course, options, and that's my point. I need an option added to the lease to accomplish that task. Security, you can secure your lease to the property with a deed of trust, as I've done many, many times. Okay, so now let's get into why do I think you guys should consider master leasing. First of all, when you're starting, and some of you are starting, you don't have a ton of capital. And it's the greatest way to get going with, because you don't require a lot of capital. It's what we're telling our kids to do. And as I told you, my son-in-law has master leased between 90 and 100 houses. If you do a performance lease, how much capital do you need? You need to have a computer. You don't need to have an office. There's not much overhead. You can get going easily. Now, is it how to make $5 million in 3 minutes without working? No. No, it's not. I mean, you got to put your shoes on. You got to work. And anything in this real estate business, it's not a get rich quick. It's a get rich real slow. But if you work at it, it will produce an income not only for you and your family, but for your kids and future generations down the road. Less risk than ownership if property values drop. Think about this for a second. Do you know anyone that got hurt in the 08 through 010 time period owning real estate? I know a lot of guys that were wiped out. So do you think it would have been easier to get out of title if you owned it or out of a lease? If you created the lease. How many times do you buy a property that you don't have to sign someone else's paperwork? Either a title company's, a lender's, someone's paperwork. Pretty much every time, right? Well, this is a different deal. This is, you can draft by design and not by default. You create all your paperwork. So when you're drafting paperwork as the master tenant, do you think that lease is pro-landlord or pro-tenant? And then when you turn around and create your paperwork between you and the occupant, do you think that paperwork is pro-landlord now that you're the landlord or pro-tenant? So you can be Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, okay? You have permission. And it's not that you're in the business of abusing folks, because I really think we're all in the business of providing good long-term housing to good folks. I think there's a tremendous need for that, and I think that I just feel very good about what we do. And you won't be in the business long-term if you abuse folks. But for example, it was pointed out, if I do a fixed lease with someone, I might agree that I'll pay the first $75 of anything that goes wrong in a month. Well, my occupant tenants might agree in their lease with me that they'll pay the first $75 of anything that goes wrong in a month. So how much does it really cost me? Not much. Not much. Question. Well, in a master lease, your tenant has the right to sublease it and make a spread. They're not the occupant. There may be multiple leases below the owner's lease with the first tenant. Okay?
That's the primary difference.
Primary difference is there will be someone below that master tenant that is paying the master tenant before the master tenant is paying the landlord. And there may be a series of leases. Okay, yeah. Say that again, I'm sorry. What's the average length for a master lease? Yeah. Yeah, the answer to most real estate questions that I know is it depends. Because really what you're doing is you're seeing what their needs are. And
LA, I own a house that can get $3,000 a month for 2,000 square foot house.
Yep. Yep.
So I don't know anyone, so someone comes to me. I don't know anyone that comes to me.
Well, don't your occupants come to you and agree to make that payment? So they do. You know a lot of people who agree to come do that.
So it's just a spread.
It's just a spread. It's whatever the spread is. I mean, I can give you some examples. I gave you one that I leased a property for 35 years at a fixed rent. The first 2 years I lost money. Why? I put in the sprinkler system, I put in new carpet, I painted the house. After 10 years, I was making more than twice what I was paying out to the owners. It depends how much time you've got. Longer time, you can take a narrower spread up front. Shorter time, you need a bigger spread up front. I leased another house one time. These are simple deals, but I had two school teachers that moved from Colorado Springs to Las Vegas. and they wanted me to lease their house, and they were absolutely adverse to risk, so they wanted me to guarantee the rent. And I offered them either $9.95 a month for 4 years, or $9.95 for 3 years, and $10.95 for 3 more years. They took the second choice. Now, what did that mean? It meant I didn't offer a long enough lease. That's what it really meant. But that's the deal they did. What was my spread? I leased it on day one for $12.95. So a $300 spread in my market, when I did that way back when, was better than a management fee. Okay?
So it's a spread plus all the taxes. Plus all the taxes.
Yeah, I'm in it for the money. Maybe someone's not in it for the money, but I'm in it for the money. And the spread can be, the spread, on that 35-year lease, trust me, when I got half the appreciation, I got a lot more. When my son-in-law just got $70-some thousand, and we're not talking Pasadena, California prices, we're talking Colorado Springs, so take a zero off, or add a zero to my prices, and that may more equate to yours. But this can be done in Santa Barbara, California, it can be done in Naples, Florida, it can be done any place. Because if I'm doing a performance lease for you, it's because you want out of the joys of management. And I'm not going to pay you more than I'm going to get. I'm going to give you a percentage of what I get. And whatever I'm paying you, that spread can be, it's the first bite out of the apple. That's the first negotiation. And once I've got that first negotiation, then we will continue to negotiate over time. And if I underpromise and overperform and you like the way I perform, when you decide you want to sell the property and you're no longer living in the town, who are you going to contact? Who are you going to be willing to finance? There's some wonderful benefits, and let me just cover a few more because I think you'll see some of them. Yeah, sure.
I have to be physically aware of how many sub-leases you're going to have to take.
Does the owner have to be completely aware of how many sub-leases I have in place? No. The owner has to know that I'm leasing it with the intent to sub-lease it to make a profit. To make income. They have to know that. I disclose that. I say, this is my business. In most cases, I've been doing this long enough that people are coming to me and they think they're hiring me to manage their property because they know I have a reputation to manage property well. So I will spend a lot of time developing their needs, why they're there, what they want to accomplish. And quite honestly, I'd much rather tell them about our great systems and how good we are, but you've got to ask people questions. You've got to show that you're concerned about them. And so once I've developed all of that, and people like it when you ask them questions, then I let them know I'm not for sale, they can't hire me. But that I think we might be able to do business under other terms. And then it's, do you want to take the risk and you get the reward, which will be a performance lease, or do you want me to take the risk and I'll get the reward? Or we'll do some kind of a hybrid in between. But let's look at some of more of the benefits for a minute and then we'll get into the management. So you can draft by design, not by default. There's no standard paperwork. Income is passive and can increase over time versus note income. How many people in here are in the note business? Okay, the note business, first of all, portfolio income. Toughest kind of income to shelter, very toughest. I had the luxury of running about a $3 million note portfolio side by side next to a $3 million house portfolio. And I'm here to tell you, I much prefer the house portfolio. Now, both of them produce income secured by houses, right? One's a tenant paying you, the other's an owner paying you. But let's think about the differences for a second. First of all, the tenant paying you, that income's pretty much hedged to inflation. As inflation goes up, you raise the rent. On the note portfolio, quite different. Usually it's fixed rent. And if interest rates drop through the floor, they come back and say, if you won't renegotiate, I'm going to go get a loan from someone else. So your income, in fact, goes down. And if it gets too tough for them, they leave the keys in the mailbox. But you tell me, if you lose income from a note payment, meaning people stop paying you, or you lose income from a tenant, which can you replace faster? You gotta foreclose on the note. That takes time. On the tenant, you can go see the tenant and essentially have a little discussion and say, how can I help you solve your problem? It's not my problem, it's your problem. Should I have the truck here tomorrow to help load you up? Where's mom and dad live? Where are you going to go? I'm not going to let you keep your head in the sand because it's not going to get better for you. It's going to get worse. It's a much easier business on the tenants than it is with the notes, in my opinion. Plus, with the tenants, you can schedule that all payments come in 5 minutes a month. If you use ACH, you can take it right out of their bank accounts. On the notes, you can't do that. On the notes, they pay you when the notes say they must pay you or sometimes later. And that means the payments come in dribs and drabs over a period of time, which means you've got to put your shoes on and go to the bank regularly, which I think is a drag. So there's, and notes get paid off, and then you got to go buy another one. And for me, it's very hard to buy a good note with a good yield, especially today. And yet to do a master lease, not very hard. It does work anywhere. With houses you can't afford to purchase. The first house I bought is one I would never buy today. It cost me $28,500. I took subject to an 8% VA loan. We got the down payment by borrowing off our credit cards. I and another guy, I did do a partnership on that. Well, we did a joint venture. And it had, it was a little three-bedroom house with a one-car garage, and the inside of the garage door had sheetrock all over it and a raised floor, and that was a family room with a speckled ceiling with no window in that room. And it was romantic. It was dark. The house couldn't even afford carpet. It was vinyl throughout the whole house. And, you know, there was a knife stabbing across the street. We had a fire in the house. They stole a chandelier off the ceiling and stole a conical fireplace out of our romantic garage. Right, romantic garage. You don't have to deal with this stuff on a master lease. You can go after the low-hanging fruit, the good stuff. You can go after the neighborhoods that you think will provide the best tenants, because you're only going to pay a percentage of what you get if and when you get it. That's the safest way to start. Does that make sense? Do you see how that works? Okay. You can control the property without ownership. Valuable leases can be borrowed against, subleased or sold. Little bureaucratic control. You don't come after under the Bureau of Real Estate Regulation. You're just an entrepreneur that's making an individual deal. No competition. There is no competition. To my knowledge, now my wife keeps me honest when I say something that's not true, but I don't know anyone other than my son-in-law and myself. There are some other people that we've taught, I guess, but very few people in my town ever do master leasing. And it's really like shooting fish in a barrel. If you can get in front of folks, it's not that bad. And you can test drive the properties, as Dave Doyle said. That your master leasing the properties is very much like you get to test drive a car and take it around the corner and see what you think. Has anyone ever here in this room ever bought a property that looked right, smelled right, and tasted right, and when they got it, it wasn't right? I mean, I've done that. I lost $50,000 on one house during times that were supposed to be not that bad. That happens. Things happen. You've got drainage problems. You've got neighbors with dogs problems. You have any number of different problems. The neighborhood changes. Not all houses make good rentals. But if you're master leasing it, you can look at it and see what you think. And if you don't like it, throw it away. You don't have to go any further. If you like it, negotiate. Talk to people. Whittle and rock. Get to know people. People want to do business with people they trust. So they gotta trust you, and you gotta be trustworthy. That means you've got to do what you say you're gonna do, and I think you gotta do more than you say you're gonna do. You gotta underpromise and overperform. It's a very low profile. In this day and age of litigation, no one knows what you got. They don't see it. If you have secured leases, at worst, you look like you're a lender. You just have deeds of trust in the public record. Nothing else. Very, very private. Negative cash flow property can provide you positive cash flow. Think about this for a second. You don't really care what the owner's payments are. Your whole marketing ploy with some of these folks are, we'll lose you less than you're losing right now with a vacant house. So what you really want to know is that credit's important to these people, and they have the financial ability to keep making their payments. Or if they don't, they have a big enough equity in the property that your secured lease, you'll be second in in place to be able to buy it wholesale at foreclosure, because anyone else will come behind you. Do you follow that? If I have a lease and I secure my lease and I secure it with a deed of trust and I put a big figure on that deed of trust, and if the owner asks me about it, I'll say, I'm sticking my neck out. I'm guaranteeing you make all these payments and everything else. And if I lose my lease because you don't make your payments, I've made a terrible error and I should never have done this deal. So sign here, press hard, and we'll record this. And so I've got this big loan that look, you know, securing this lease behind whatever is foreclosed. Anyone else has to take me out of it, or I've got, which would be good, because I'd be paid off at a high figure, or I can get to buy the house. Does everyone understand that? It is a lien. Okay. How do I secure a lease? Now, my understanding is California is a trust deed state. Is that correct? Okay. So in California, you have a note, typically, which is your promise to pay, and you glue that promise to a property with a deed of trust. Okay?
Correct.
But the deed of trust is not the promise to pay. It's just the glue that glues the promise to pay to the property. Okay? So I use that glue to glue my lease to the property. And my lease says that the owner's promise to pay the taxes and the insurance and the underlying encumbrances. And if they don't, I'll foreclose them. Okay? And I put a value in that deed of trust. First time I did put a deed of trust on a property, I did not put a value on it. There's no requirement to put a value on it, but it gets very confusing with the public bureaucracy as to how do you have a deed of trust that doesn't have a value. And they also think it's quite unusual that the tenant has the owner secure the owner's promises on the property rather than the tenant securing their promises using another property. But you can do these things. How do you compute the value? Totally arbitrary. You come up with something that makes sense. On the deal that I did, when the people had a negative cash flow of, I can't remember what it was, I took the negative cash flow times 84 months, and I said that was the value of the lease, of the security. I just had to have something that made sense for the owner. It's a totally bogus, arbitrary number that I said, I deemed my value of my leasehold interest, which transfers some of the bundle of ownership rights in this real estate to me, has a value of X. Totally arbitrary.
It's not based on the assessed value.
Nope, got nothing to do with the assessed value. I want to suck up all the equity in the property is really my objective. Yeah, that's what you want.
No matter what figure you choose, it's not going to hurt you if you have to foreclose?
No, can't hurt me. If I foreclose, I don't have to pay any money for the debt owed me. You follow me?
Yeah.
Yeah, it won't hurt me at all. Won't hurt me at all. Yeah.
So, ideally, you'll find somebody who's having some sort of trouble getting tenants, but then you'll be able to get tenants for like more than what they were asking for. Can you go into like some strategies for finding tenants? Because that strikes me as maybe a business.
Question is management, right? That's the second page. So we're getting there, and I've got, how much more time do I have? I need to have an idea. Okay, so let me just move quickly then, because I think the management's key. But one or two things on this page still. Leases can be long-term. Most management contracts can't. They can only go for a year at a time, give or take. Since you're drafting it, you can make sure that you have escape clauses if necessary. You can make sure that any big ticket items are paid for the owner by the owner. A new roof, any problems with asbestos, sewers, lead paint, all of those things. You can maintain your day job. Too often I have people tell me they need to quit what they're doing and get into real estate full time so they have the time to do it. I don't recommend that. I recommend that you keep multiple sources of income initially. You put your big toe in the water, you try this one time, you see how bad it hurts. And if it doesn't hurt, then you do it again. You build up income streams before you shoot yourself in the foot, cutting off whatever puts food on your table today. Let's go over to the next page, because that is the question. What's the problem? Problem is management. No one likes management. They don't want to deal with tenants and toilets. They think that they'd much rather hire the nice man. I believe that management is really the easy part of this business as long as you've got the systems in place. So let's go through my bullet points, and hopefully that will give you some ideas. In a perfect world, you'd like numerous prospects to view your properties without ever having to answer a phone or put your shoes on to meet them. You'd like your applicants to weed themselves out before filling out applications, thereby saving yourself valuable time screening. We do these things. Our application is really looks professional. It's a number of pages, and people that we would rather not deal with right off the bat, they take a look and say, he's too kept, let's go someplace else. And in by doing that, I've just dodged a bullet. I haven't had to deal with them. Each prospective tenant would use the application to convince you of the benefit of choosing him or her to be your next tenant. You should not be selling people as to why they should rent your stuff, rent your properties. They should be selling you as to why you should give them the keys to the castle. Big difference in psychology, very, very important. Their applications to rent your property would appear magically in your inbox or on your desk by fax before you've ever spoken to them. You'd be able to compare these multiple applications side by side in order to have the best application rise to the top. Now, I'll point out that Seattle, Washington has just created a new law that makes that illegal. They've said that you have to look at each application as it comes in, first come, first serve. Which means, someone called me on this the other day, and I said, well, that means you need to create a system so that all applications appear at the exact same time, so you still get to decide which one you want to look at first. You got to see what the law says, see what it didn't say, and do it. Now, you don't want to break any federal, state, or local fair housing laws, and I don't. I just want good people. I'm kind of like the Marines. I'm looking for a few good men. The accepted applicants would move in, pay rent early every month, stay for life, or for at least 5 years, and improve your property for as long as they live there. Now, I have to be honest with you and tell you that last year, I had the highest turnover I've ever had in any of my properties. I typically have properties, tenants stay for about 5.7 years. Last year, we lost two-thirds of our tenants in 1 year. And that was a real tough deal for us, and there was a number of reasons for it, but I am here to tell you that I did not lose one day's rent, and I raised the rent in every case. But the hassle factor will really drive you crazy if you can't figure that out. So I had to relook at my systems and say, what have I done wrong in putting those people in? And this year, we had turnover of only one house. So you've got to constantly look at what have I done, what's wrong, how can I improve? Inspection should take place automatically without you having to put on your shoes. All this would take place in a manner that would eliminate make-ready time, allowing you to transition from a tenant to an existing tenant to your new tenant without losing a day of rent or spending a dime on turnover. Question for you. How often do your tenants turn over? Do they turn over once a year? Once every 2 years? I mean, give me a number. Let's say they turn over once a year, just as an example. And what day of the month do they move out? Typically. Yeah, the end of the month, right? What day do people move in? First. So you're a crackerjack manager, and you can turn your properties and make them ready for the next tenant in 3 days. How much rent have you lost? You lost a month. How much rent is that? That's 8.33%. 8.33%. 4.16 if they turn over every 2 years. You can't afford that. Why can't you afford that? Well, first of all, you never gain that back. But secondly, you need caretakers in your house. In some parts of the country, if a house is vacant, the air conditioning compressor walks off. When metal prices go up, you'll find copper wiring and plumbing is taken out of the walls. You need people in your houses. You can't afford to have downtime. You collect the rent in 5 minutes each month by debiting it from their tenants' bank accounts prior to the first, so that your monthly bank reconciliations the next day online would reconcile your rents for the subsequent month. Tenants would solve problems on their own, contact authorized vendors, leaving you out of the loop in most cases, and your consistent procedures that you use would protect you from violating fair housing. Does that really happen real world? Not 100% of the time. But if you take the position that when you have a failure, it's not the tenant's failure, it's your failure. Something went wrong with your system. You didn't share expectations correctly. You didn't deal with someone with the right moral code. How can you change your systems to be better the next time? If you do that, you'll find you get better and better and better at doing this. The only eviction we ever did was in 1981. We haven't done one since then. We do typically go from a tenant to a tenant with no downtime. Mary and I have no employees, and we run our properties in Colorado Springs from wherever we are. Now, I want to point out that that does not mean that I advocate you buy properties anywhere and manage them from where you live. I don't advocate that. I moved to Colorado Springs in 1975 and I raised my family there. All our networks are there. This whole meeting is about networking. And I have plumbers, electricians, I have people that when I have a problem, they'll solve the problem. I can manage our properties in Colorado Springs from Naples, Florida, infinitely better than I could ever manage properties in Naples, Florida from Naples, Florida. Why? I don't have the network. Plus, the area that I live in is a resort community that people are only there about 3 or 4 months a year. And to trap people for long periods of time would be very difficult. Our longest tenant was with us for 24 years and 10 months. Our next longest one, 18 years. Those are profitable situations. I think my time is up. I'll be around. Is it up or?
It is 9:03.
Okay.
Perfect.
Okay.
Sure.
You always have a shill in the room. I appreciate it because I totally forget to ever say anything, quite honestly. So thank you. Yes, I do. We do one seminar a year, and it is coming up next month. It's the 9th, 10th, and 11th of September. It's in Las Vegas. We do have some brochures around here someplace, I think. Okay, front table. And my phone number is on there. Since I have no employees, if you ever try and contact me, you get my cell phone. I put my Bluetooth in the morning. I take it out at night, and I don't screen my calls, so you can reach me. Yes. Yeah, I do. I've heard some folks recently that have been doing that very, very successfully. You know, I'm not an estate builder really anymore. I'm an ender. I don't want to start over. I'm lazy. And Airbnb, you've got to do some things. But I think it's a wonderful way to make a living. We're staying in an Airbnb tonight and right here. So I think good opportunities. Yeah. Yeah, and incidentally, a couple of the examples I gave were that exactly. I mean, think of Jan Leisure. She did short-term vacation rentals. She rented stuff, did very, very well. Yeah.
How do you do make rent with no
doubt? I don't. I motivate the tenants to do a very good job cleaning up the properties and convincing the next tenants to move in. And in fact, I do all my rehab as a rule with the tenant in there, meaning I pull whole kitchens out, knock walls out between living rooms and kitchens, and tenants don't have kitchens for 6 weeks sometimes, and they thank me for it. Because I plant the seed that what would you like if I could get the owners to do it, and we do those things, and then when we're done, it gives me a justification for a rent increase, or if they move, it looks that much better for the next guy. You work with your tenants, But my tenants do an incredible job for us. We had a tenant do a 350 square foot addition to a house, which included an Olympic sports size master bath with tub, shower, double sink, skylight, wood parquet flooring, and oak trim, and some other things. So our tenants do some very nice things. We did pay for the materials. Yeah. No.
They're real tenants. They're renting.
Oh, well, I guess I've got to apologize and say, you know, I have properties that somehow trickle into my tax returns. And those properties are leased to my corporation. My corporation leases them to the tenants, okay? On our master leases, depending on whether they're fixed thank you, performance. I need lots of help. They will be leased to my company, but back when I would sublease them out to another company, they would deal with the tenants, I would deal with the owners. So I have several different books of business, if that makes sense.
But if you're dealing with the tenants directly, then how do you motivate, what is the motivation factor they pay like rent?
Okay, good question. When you're dealing with tenants, you're either going to be using the carrot or the stick to motivate the tenants, okay? The stick is, most landlords want to use the stick. They first of all sign a lease with the tenant and they say, sign here, press hard, last copy is yours, read it later if you want, move into the house, sit in a chair, face the wall, and don't touch anything. And if you do anything wrong, we're going to beat you up by taking your security deposit. We don't take that approach. We say, here's the house, now go make it a home. And we'll pay a performance bonus after you moved out based on how you performed, for performance above and beyond the call of duty. Now, we'll give examples to people moving in about the guy who did the 350 square foot addition on the house. And we'll say, what's your big idea? What would you like to do? We want to think of these, we want these tenants to take our house and make it their home. We don't want people, quote unquote, camping out in our house. We don't want people who have an entitlement mentality. We don't want people with a victim mentality. Those are the key things. You want people to internalize and really enjoy living in their home. Yeah. Mary, would you like to answer that? You do that more than I do. Why don't you answer that? Here's the mic. Come up here.
Yes,
sir, come up. Yeah.
The most important thing that we have to do once we've got the right person in there, you know, kind of run the show. So we really need to spend that time up front, and it's going to pay off in spades. So our application, David said, it's pretty lengthy, and we actually ask some of those questions you probably want to know. We ask skills that you have, you know, like painting, carpentry, plumbing, whatever. And we also have spaces so they can fill in the blank. Landscaping. We ask...
Tools you own.
We recently added vacuum cleaner on there because we had a tenant move in to one of our properties that we own, and it just happened to come out when we moved in that we asked, that we said, well, it'd be easier if you just vacuum, you know. And he said, oh,
what's
well, I
that?
Don't have a vacuum. So now we have that on there as well as lawn tools, lawnmower, things like that. So we ask those questions, but also, how do you...
Sorry, I'll take it back.
You put me on the spot here.
No, I mean, information is power. And if I walked you through, I just don't have the time to do it all right now, but more information is better than less. We get a separate application from everyone over the age of 18. Not everyone's been married to the same person for 43 years, but I want multiple applications because I get more information. We get 5-year landlord history on everyone who applies for a house. And if you've been 40 years at the same place, I want to know where you were one time before that. We ask some very specific questions. How long were you with your past landlords, and what were the dates? We want to make sure they don't skip one where they had kind of an unpleasant situation. We talk to people. We do ask, and we'll ask landlords, what have we not asked you? What should we know? And oftentimes you'll find they'll give you a landlord, and you'll find the landlord might be their mom. And you know, they're not going to say something bad about you. If you get enough information, you can get a feel for people. And all I can tell you is, yes, we do use FICO scores. Yes, we do use employment and show stability. Yes, we do. I mean, we do all of those things. And when we add it all together, all I can tell you is our last eviction was a urologist out of a house in 1981. We haven't had any problems since then. Well, no, we've had problems, but no problems that we had to do any evictions. And I'll be around after the meeting, so I will answer anything else that anyone wants.
Could you give a round of applause?